Good morning all. So I'll be taking water and electrolytes lecture today, and this will be followed by acid base balance, pH balance and acid base disorders. So this lecture would form the basis of further lectures, and you need to understand the water balance, how it is maintained in our body, and electrolyte balance of course, and what are the various electrolyte imbalances that we encounter in clinical practice, and what are their symptoms and what are their etiologies. So my focus will be this only, and competency covered in this lecture is BI 6.7 and the specific learning objectives that it will be that you should be able to describe the structure and function of water in our body, its distribution in various compartments of the body and transport of water across the cell, and then you should be able to describe various hormones that are involved in maintaining water and electrolyte balance in our body, and what are the various disorders associated with dysfunction of these hormones. So let us start. So this figure here shows you structure of the water molecule. Water is the most abundant substance in living systems, making up 70% or more out of the weight of most organisms. And in this ball and stick model of the structure of water shown here, each hydrogen atom, as you can see in the figure, each hydrogen atom of a water molecule, it shares an electron pair with the central oxygen atom. And the oxygen nucleus attracts electrons more strongly than does the hydrogen nucleus. That is, oxygen is more electronegative. This means that the shared electrons are more often in the vicinity of the oxygen atom than of the hydrogen. The result of this unequal electron sharing is two electric dipoles in the water molecule. So, two electric dipoles in the water molecule are created, one along each of the HO bonds. So each atom, each hydrogen atom bears a partial positive charge, and the oxygen atom bears partial negative charge. As you can see in figure B, two water molecules joined by a hydrogen bond, these three blue lines. This results because there is an electrostatic attraction between the oxygen atom of one water molecule and the hydrogen of another water molecule. And as you can guess from the bond length shown in figure, hydrogen bonds are longer and weaker than covalent OH bonds. And hydrogen bonding gives water its unusual properties of high melting point, boiling point and heat of vaporization than most other common solvents. We know that water is known to be the universal solvent. Water dissolves many crystalline salts by hydrating their component ions. For example, I have shown here the sodium chloride salt. So the sodium chloride crystal lattice is disrupted as water molecules cluster about the chloride and sodium ions. The ionic charges are partially neutralized, and the electrostatic attractions necessary for lattice formation are weakened. As a salt such as sodium chloride dissolves, the sodium and chloride ions having the crystal lattice acquire far greater freedom of motion, and this resulting in increased entropy or randomness of the system is largely responsible for the ease of dissolving salts such as sodium chloride in water. Now this figure here shows how amphipathic compounds in aqueous solution are dissolved. So in figure A, as you can see, long chain fatty acids, they have very hydrophobic alkyl chains, each of which is surrounded by a layer of highly ordered water molecule. As you can see in figure B, the highly ordered water molecules, they form cages around the hydrophobic alkyl chains. So this is our long chain fatty acid having a long alkyl chain, and this alkyl chain has been encaged by ordered fashion of water molecules, and here lies the hydrophilic head group. Now in figure B, what we see is by clustering together in micelles, the fatty acid molecules expose the smallest possible hydrophobic surface area to the water, and fewer water molecules are required in the shell of ordered water. So the energy gained by freeing immobilized water molecules stabilizes the micelle. Now you are asked a viva question a lot many times, that what are amphipathic compounds? I'm sure you must be having some idea of it. Let me just tell you in more detail. So amphipathic compounds contain regions that are polar or charged and regions that are non-polar. For example, phenylalanine, phosphatidylcholine. So when an amphipathic compound is mixed with water, the polar or the hydrophilic region, it interacts favorably with the water and tends to dissolve. But the non-polar hydrophobic region, it tends to avoid contact with the water, like shown in this figure. The non-polar regions of the molecules cluster together to present the smallest hydrophobic area to the aqueous solvent, and the polar regions are arranged to maximize their interaction with the solvent. This phenomena is called the hydrophobic effect. These stable structures of amphipathic compounds in water, called micelles, they may contain hundreds or thousands of molecules, and the forces that hold the non-polar regions of the molecules together are sometimes referred to as hydrophobic interactions. So of course we know that water polar compounds ko water hamare body mein travel karne mein, it's not a big deal because they are polar, they can easily dissolve with water. But non-polar compounds, yes, if they are amphipathic, they can to an extent they can be transported like this, but non-polar substances, they cannot dissolve in water and cannot travel freely in the body. Now coming to one important phenomena, I'm sure you already know this phenomena, that is osmosis. So osmosis is water movement across a semi-permeable membrane driven by differences in osmotic pressure, right? And it is an important factor in the life of most cells. Now plasma membranes are more permeable to water than to most other small molecules, ions and macromolecules, because protein channels or the aquaporins in the membrane selectively permit the passage of water. Now this figure here shows you how we can measure osmotic pressure. Now, A is the initial state. So the tube contains an aqueous solution. The beaker contains pure water, and the semi-permeable membrane allows the passage of water but not the solute. So this tube here has a non-permeant solute. Non-permeant solute dissolved in water, and this is the pure water in the beaker, and you have a semi-permeable membrane here which allows the passage of water but not the solute. So water flows from the beaker into the tube to equalize its concentration across the membrane. Now in the final state, water has moved into the solution of the non-permeant compound, diluting it and raising the column of solution within the tube. At equilibrium, the force of gravity operating on the solution in the tube exactly balances the tendency of water to move into the tube where its concentration is lower. So how do we actually measure ki osmotic pressure kitna create hua? Osmotic pressure is measured as the force that must be applied to return the solution in the tube to the level of water in the beaker. This force is proportional to the height h of the column in figure B. I hope this idea of osmosis and what is osmotic pressure and how it is measured, it is somewhat clear to you. I'm sure you already know this, but I still need to emphasize. This figure here shows you the effect of extracellular osmolarity on water movement across a plasma membrane. So in figure A, as you can see, cell is in isotonic solution. That means the osmolarity of extracellular fluid and intracellular fluid is equal. So there is no net water movement. So when a cell is in osmotic balance with its surrounding medium, that is a cell in figure A, an isotonic medium. When it is transferred to, let us say, a hypertonic solution or a hypotonic solution, water moves across the plasma membrane in the direction that tends to equalize osmolarity outside and inside the cell. Right? So, if the cell is put in a hypertonic solution, water will move out from intracellular to extracellular, and when a cell is put in hypotonic solution, the water will move in, creating outward pressure. The cell will swell and it can lead to lysis of the cell. So this becomes important when we read about water balance, how various compartments of the body maintain water balance. That is why it was necessary to emphasize it here. Okay. Now let us come to the normal physiology that exists in our body fluid compartments. So water accounts for approximately 60% of body weight in men and 55% in women, the difference reflecting the typically greater body fat content in women. Approximately 66% of this water is in the intracellular fluid, ICF, and 33% in the extracellular fluid, that is ECF. And about 7 to 8% of body water is in the plasma. As I told before, water is not actively transported in the body. It is in general freely permeable through the ICF and ECF, and its distribution is determined by the osmotic contents of these compartments. We'll see in subsequent slides that what are these osmotically active components that create the osmotic pressure, which dictates the movement of water across the various compartments, that is either ICF to ECF or ECF to ICF. So any change in the solute content of a compartment engenders a shift of water which restores isotonicity. Now, under normal circumstances, the amounts of water taken into the body and lost from it are equal over a period of time. So water is obtained from the diet and oxidative metabolism. Now, how much water is produced from oxidative metabolism? Of course, we oxidize the fuel that we take, carbs, fats and proteins. So oxidative metabolism, that is water produced during oxidation of foodstuffs. 1 gram carbohydrates, they produce 0.6 ml of water. 1 gram protein releases 0.4 ml water, and 1 gram fat generates 1.1 milliliter of water. So intake of about 1000 kilocalorie produces 125 ml of water. So this was about intake, that is what we take in diet, and water which is produced from oxidative metabolism. Now let's talk about the output. Water is lost through the kidneys, skin, lungs and gut, and some amount in sweat also. Some 170 liter of water is filtered by the kidneys every 24 hours. And almost all of this is reabsorbed. So the minimum volume of urine necessary for normal excretion of waste products is about 500 ml per 24 hours. But as a result of obligatory losses by other routes, the minimum daily water intake necessary for the maintenance of water balance is approximately 1100 ml, and this increases if losses are abnormally large, for example with excessive sweating, like nowadays we have summer, so we are sweating a lot, so you have to consider that when you decide your water intake. So such losses, like in sweating, they increase in summers, or if the patient is having diarrhea, if in that case water loss will be increased through feces. Now water intake is usually considerably greater than the minimum requirement, but the excess is easily excreted through the kidneys. So we can say that the input is equal to output. So if you just add it up, water gain 200 plus 700, 900, 900 plus 1600 is 2500 ml. And water loss 100 ml plus 300, 400, 400 plus 600 is 1000, 1000 plus 1500 is 2500. So input is equal to output. So when you go to clinics or wards in subsequent years, you'll see that doctor on duty or the consultants, they would ask nursing staff to do IO charting, that is input output charting. Basically they want to measure how much fluid the patient has taken, be it through oral route or parenteral route, IV route, and how much is the urine output. Or you can measure that, you can catheterize the patient, and measuring the volume of urine produced in the urine bag, you can measure the output. So they measure fluid input and output to see various conditions. For example, if the patient is not going into fluid overload, right? Now, before we talk about how body water is maintained in different body fluid compartments, it is necessary to know the composition of each compartment, which is shown here in this table. So if you look carefully, there are few findings which you can deduce from here. I would like you to jot down in your notebook as you listen. So as you can see in the table, sodium is the major cation of extracellular fluid. And potassium is the major intracellular cation and maintains intracellular osmotic pressure. Right? Third thing, intake, output and metabolism of sodium and chloride run in parallel. So the homeostasis of sodium, potassium and chloride, they are interrelated. Next point is the bicarbonate buffer system. It is the most important in the extracellular fluid. Yet at normal ECF hydrogen ion concentrations, the concentration of carbonic acid is about 1.2 millimoles per liter, while that of bicarbonate is 20 times greater. You will read about bicarbonate metabolism in subsequent classes on acid-base balance. Now there are two terms. One is osmolarity, which means osmotic pressure exerted by the number of moles per liter of the solution. And another term is osmolality, which is the osmotic pressure exerted by the number of moles per kg of solvent. So many a times we use this term exchangeably. Since osmolality is dependent on the number of solute particles, the major determinant factor deciding the osmolality of a body water body fluid compartment, it is the sodium. So therefore, sodium and water balance, they are dependent on each other and cannot be considered separately. Also, to some extent, potassium, calcium, magnesium, urea, proteins, they also contribute to the osmolality. The osmolality of plasma varies from 280 to 290 milliosmol per kg. At some places it is given as 280 to 295 millimol per kg of water. So roughly it is 280 to 290 only. And when the serum osmolality becomes too dilute, that is less than 280 milliosmol per kg, excess water is excreted by the kidneys as dilute urine. Conversely, when the serum osmolality becomes too concentrated, that is more than 290, ADH, that is antidiuretic hormone or vasopressin, it is released and thirst result in water retention to bring the system back into balance. And of course, there is role of proteins, which I haven't mentioned here. Albumin is mainly responsible in maintaining the osmotic balance. I'm sure you must be knowing about Stirling forces and how edema develops. Now, there are two terms which I want you to search for. One is effective osmolality. I'll repeat, effective osmolality, and what is osmolar gap? Effective osmolality and osmolar gap. One thing that I didn't tell you, that how osmolarity is calculated. So osmolarity is twice the sodium concentration plus urea plus glucose. Twice the sodium concentration plus urea plus glucose, where all concentrations are measured in millimole per liter. and this factor of two, which I said, it is to allow for the major anions, chloride and bicarbonate. Okay, so the very purpose of showing you this figure here is to emphasize on predominance of potassium, phosphate and magnesium intracellularly, and predominance of sodium and chloride and bicarbonate extracellularly. Now, one implication of this is that if you get a hemolyzed sample, I'm sure you must have been told in when a class on phlebotomy was taken, that what are the common pre-analytical errors that we encounter in lab, that many a times we get a sample hemolyzed. It looks reddish in appearance, the serum is red because the cells have lysed, the RBCs have broken down and the contents have been released into the serum. So one implication of it is that if you get a hemolyzed sample in lab for analysis, potassium and phosphate, these are two analytes which you would not like to analyze and report, since they'll give you spurious values because the intracellular content has been released already. So you may get a spuriously high result of potassium and phosphate. Okay. Now this figure shows the broad physiological response to water loss or dehydration. So any loss of water from the ECF, such as occurs with water deprivation, will increase its osmolality, ECF osmolality will increase, and it results in movement of water from the ICF to the ECF. However, a slight increase in ECF osmolality will still occur, stimulating the hypothalamic thirst center, causing thirst and thus promoting a desire to drink. Also, there is stimulation of hypothalamic osmoreceptors, which causes the release of vasopressin or the antidiuretic hormone ADH. So, can we say that the effectors of osmoregulation are ADH and thirst? Then there are effectors for volume regulation, namely renin angiotensin aldosterone system, the RAS system, atrial natriuretic peptide ANP, and the sympathetic nervous system. One important thing to be kept in mind is that the most osmotically sensitive organ in the body is the brain. So the most osmotically sensitive organ in the body is brain. Therefore, it should not be surprising that symptoms of hyponatremia and hypernatremia, they predominantly involve the nervous system as water shifts into or out of the neurons. Now the figure here shows structure of a nephron and movement of various molecules across its different parts. So talking about sodium, sodium balance is maintained by regulation of its renal excretion. Sodium excretion is dependent on glomerular filtration. Normally, approximately 70% of filtered sodium is actively reabsorbed in the proximal convoluted tubules, with further reabsorption in the loops of Henle. Sodium reabsorption is reduced in the PCTs if blood volume increases, because this is associated with a fall in the oncotic pressure in the peritubular capillary blood, and if sympathetic activity decreases, such as also tends to occur with an increase in blood volume. Now the distal convoluted tubules and collecting ducts, they comprise the major site for fine tuning, fine control of sodium excretion. Right. Now talking about this hormone aldosterone, which is the most important mineralocorticoid, it is released from adrenal cortex in response to activation of renin-angiotensin system. It stimulates sodium reabsorption in the distal parts of DCT and collecting ducts, and is the major factor controlling renal sodium excretion. About vasopressin or ADH, it renders the renal collecting ducts permeable to water. What happens, its combination with V2 receptors results in the insertion of aquaporins or water channels into the normally impermeable apical membrane of the cells of the collecting tubules, permitting water reabsorption and concentration of the urine. Moving to the next slide. Now we talk about renin-angiotensin-aldosterone system, ANP and ADH in detail. So this figure is very important, and you should spend some time over it and try to understand, but not a difficult thing to understand actually. So whenever there is a decrease in renal perfusion, secondary to a decrease in blood volume, specifically a fall in arterial blood volume, which could happen due to blood loss, hemorrhage or a cardiac failure, right? So whenever there is a decrease in renal perfusion, secondary to a decrease in blood volume, specifically a fall in arterial blood volume, renin is released. Mind it, this is RENIN. Renin is released into the plasma from the juxtaglomerular cells of the kidney, the JG cells of the kidney, the juxtaglomerular apparatus. Renin catalyzes the formation of angiotensin 1 from angiotensinogen. Renin catalyzes formation of angiotensin 1 from angiotensinogen, which is an alpha 2 globulin released from liver. Angiotensin 1 is metabolized to an octapeptide angiotensin 2 by angiotensin converting enzyme ACE during its passage through the lungs. Now angiotensin 2, it stimulates the release of aldosterone from the adrenal cortex, and it's a powerful pressor agent and also stimulates thirst and the secretion of vasopressin or ADH. Decreased effective arterial blood volume also leads to increased sympathetic activity, manifested as constriction of renal afferent arterioles and systemic arteriolar vasoconstriction, leading to increased GFR, increased proximal sodium and water reabsorption, and restoration of blood pressure. Now, few words about atrial natriuretic peptides. So, ANP is a 28 amino acid peptide, one of a family of similar peptides secreted by the cardiac atria in response to atrial stretch following a rise in atrial pressure. That is, for example, ECF expansion has taken place, that would stretch the stretch receptors present in the cardiac atrium, and it will lead to ANP release. So basically ANP acts both directly by inhibiting distal tubular sodium reabsorption and through decreasing renin, and thereby decreasing aldosterone secretion, of course. It also antagonizes, ANP also antagonizes the pressor effects of norepinephrine and angiotensin II and has a systemic vasodilatory effect. And it appears to provide fine tuning of sodium homeostasis, but is probably more important in pathological states than physiologically. Right? Okay. Moving to the next slide. So basically the table here summarizes the various stimuli which stimulate vasopressin or ADH secretion. The osmoreceptors are highly sensitive to osmolality, responding to a change of as little as 1% plasma. The osmoreceptors which are there, they are highly sensitive to osmolality and they respond to changes as little as 1%. Plasma vasopressin concentration falls to very low values at an osmolality of 282 millimole per kg, but rises sharply if osmolality increases above this level. Other stimuli affecting vasopressin secretion include angiotensin II, arterial and venous baroreceptors, and volume receptors, which sense blood pressure and volume respectively. So, stimulating factors will be, of course, increased ECF osmolality and decreased arterial blood volume, stress. Exercise can lead to transient increase and certain drugs. Then inhibiting factors will be exactly opposite, that is ECF osmolality is decreased and hypervolemia and alcohol also. Now as you can see in this figure, hypovolemia and hypotension, the blue slope here, they increase the slope of the vasopressin response to an increase in osmolality and lower the threshold osmolality for vasopressin secretion. As you can see in this graph here, that the threshold has been decreased. Plasma osmolality threshold has been decreased in a patient with hypotension as compared to a person with normal blood pressure. So the vasopressin response to a fall in blood pressure is exponential. That is, it is relatively small with small decreases in plasma volume, but greater falls cause a massive increase in vasopressin secretion. So I would still emphasize on this, that vasopressin response to a fall in BP is exponential. So chote change ke saath kam plasma volume agar bahut small amount se kam hua hai to vasopressin small amount mein niklega, but if the osmolality has increased hugely, so there will be a exponential, there would be a greater secretion of vasopressin. Now this slide and the next slide, they summarize whatever we have started till now, that how osmolality is regulated. I would like you to spend some time on both the slides, this one and the next one, and if you don't understand it, please come back with your doubts. this figure here only summarizes the role of RAS, aldosterone, and ADH and ANP, of course. So you have to, the take home message is that sodium and water balance, they are very much, you know, interrelated, very much interrelated. Okay. So water depletion. Water depletion will occur if water intake is inadequate or if losses are excessive. Simple. Right. So depletion of water alone is seen much less frequently than depletion of both water and sodium. As sodium cannot be excreted from the body without water, sodium loss never occurs alone but is always accompanied by some loss of water. So the table here mentions causes and clinical features of predominantly water depletion. So it could be decreased intake like in infancy, old age or an unconscious patient, or it could be increased loss from various organs. And few points that I want to emphasize upon here are, unless water depletion is due to uncontrolled loss through kidneys, the urine becomes highly concentrated and there is a rapid decrease in its volume. Then signs of reduced ECF volume are not usually present. Severe water depletion, it induces cerebral dehydration which may cause cerebral hemorrhage through tearing of blood vessels. Circulatory failure, it's a very late feature of water depletion and it is much more likely to occur if sodium depletion is also present. Okay, so this slide here gives you causes and clinical features of excess body water. Water excess is usually related to an impairment of water excretion. However, the limit to the ability of the healthy kidneys to excrete water is about 20 ml per minute, and occasionally excessive intake is alone sufficient to cause water intoxication, for example in patients with psychiatric disorders who have compulsive water drinking. But otherwise the kidney has got a huge capacity to, you know, excrete water. And the clinical features of water overload, they are related to cerebral overhydration, and their incidence and severity depend upon the extent of water excess and the time course over which water intoxication has taken place. So this was about how the distribution of water in various body fluid compartments, body compartments, and how osmoregulation and volume regulation is taking place in our body, how the various factors, the various hormones regulate water balance in our body. Now we'll start with the electrolytes. So total body sodium is about 4000 milliequivalent. About 50% of it is in the bones, 40% in ECF and 10% in soft tissues. And as I told earlier, sodium is the major cation of extracellular fluid. Normal level of sodium in plasma is 136 to 145 milliequivalents per liter. In some books, it would be mentioned as 135 to 150, even that is fine. So we'll just restrict ourselves to 136 to 145 milliequivalents per liter. Now, causes of hyponatremia, that is plasma sodium level less than 136 millimole per liter. I'll not go into detail of each and every cause because I want you to think why certain factors result in hyponatremia, but certain points I'll definitely touch. So if I talk about causes of hyponatremia, either it could be excessive loss from kidneys or excessive loss from skin, excessive loss from gut, or it could be inadequate intake. So let's talk about excessive loss from kidneys, which will happen during diuretic phase of acute kidney injury, or if you are administering a diuretic therapy, because that will lead to water and sodium loss from the body. Then mineralocorticoid deficiency, cerebral salt wasting, and other salt losing states. Now from skin, if there is massively increased sweating, cystic fibrosis, which is conductor channel defect, probably you'll read about it further in subsequent classes, cystic fibrosis. And if there is widespread dermatitis, or in a patient of burns, you can see hyponatremia. Then excessive loss from gut can also take place, like in vomiting, diarrhea, intestinal fistulae are present, ileus, and intestinal obstruction. So these were the causes which were related to excessive loss of sodium from kidneys, skin, and gut. Now there could be a situation where the intake is inadequate. So sodium depletion will occur whenever intake is inadequate to balance excessive losses. Otherwise, inadequate intake alone is rarely a cause of depletion. Now, talking about the clinical features, symptoms with which a patient may present to you with hyponatremia are weakness, apathy, postural dizziness, syncope, confusion, or coma in late stages. And in signs, you may find weight loss related to decreased plasma volume. There would be tachycardia, hypertension, peripheral circulatory failure, oliguria, and related to decreased interstitial fluid, there would be decreased intraocular pressure and decreased skin turgor. There would be decreased skin turgor. Now, this is the algorithm for evaluation of hyponatremia. You can go through it, try to understand it as much as you can. Few etiologies of hyponatremia I would describe here for you. Please listen carefully. So, hyperglycemia, where hypertonic hyponatremia is seen. So glucose acts as an osmotically active solute because it is restricted to the extracellular fluid in states of insulin deficiency. In the marked hyperglycemia of diabetic ketoacidosis and hyperosmolar hyperglycemic states, the ECF hyperosmolarity, which is usually more than 290 milliosmol per kg, it causes water to shift from the ICF compartment to the ECF, and dilutional hyponatremia ensues. The plasma sodium falls by 2.4 milliequivalents per liter for every 100 milligram per deciliter rise in the plasma glucose concentration above normal. Now next is edematous states where hypervolemic hyponatremia, is seen. Heart failure and cirrhosis, they result in a decreased effective circulating volume. Given the primacy of volume preservation, the body's response to this perceived threat is to hold on to salt and water with non-osmotic ADH release as part of the response. Thus, water excretion is submaximal. If the rise in total body water exceeds the increase in total, sodium, hyponatremia results. Right, so this is what? Hypervolemic hyponatremia. And the degree of hyponatremia often correlates with the severity of the underlying condition. So we talked about hypertonic hyponatremia, we talked about hypervolemic hyponatremia, and next is euvolemic hyponatremia, which is seen in syndrome of inappropriate ADH secretion. So what happens? Non-osmotic release of ADH, that is, there has been not much change in the ECF osmolality, which would dictate ADH secretion. The non-osmotic release of ADH, either from the posterior pituitary or an ectopic source, it also underlies the pathophysiology of SIADH, syndrome of inappropriate ADH secretion. However, these patients are euvolemic, indicating that a true or perceived volume stimulus is not the stimulus for ADH production. The urine osmolality is inappropriately concentrated. For the prevailing hypotonic state, indicating the inappropriate presence of ADH. Commonly associated conditions include neuropsychiatric disorders, for example, meningitis, cerebrovascular accident, and head trauma. Pulmonary diseases like pneumonia, granulomatous diseases, tuberculosis, acute respiratory failure. Then malignant tumors, most commonly small cell lung cancer. Whenever you are given a case history on SIADH, the usual etiology which is mentioned is this small cell lung cancer developing in a habitual long chain smoker. Also, deficiencies of thyroid hormone or cortisol, they can present with euvolemic hyponatremia. So go through this flow chart. You don't have to memorize each and every etiology, but then just understand the basic mechanism of hypertonic hyponatremia or hypervolemic and euvolemic hyponatremia. Okay. So next is hypernatremia. So hypernatremia, that is sodium concentration, plasma sodium concentration more than 150 millimole per liter. It is almost always the result of a relative water deficit. So the causes include either it could be increased intake, which could be due to excessive parenteral administration, or it could be absorption from saline emetics, or more commonly it could be decreased excretion, where we see what are the causes of decreased excretion? There could be decreased glomerular filtration seen in acute and chronic kidney disease, or there could be increased tubular reabsorption seen in primary mineralocorticoid excess, for example Cushing syndrome, Kahn syndrome, or there could be secondary mineralocorticoid excess like in congestive cardiac failure, nephrotic syndrome, hepatic cirrhosis with ascites, and renal artery stenosis. Now, hypernatremia means it will hold on to more water in the body. So, the clinical features with which the patient will present could be peripheral edema, dyspnea, pulmonary edema, venous congestion, weight gain, and various effusions. Now, this algorithm is for evaluation of hypernatremia. Few etiologies of special importance I'll discuss. First is diabetes insipidus. So, the appropriate renal response to hypernatremia is excretion of maximally concentrated urine. Maybe more than the urine osmolality will be more than 800 milliosmol per kg. So, the appropriate renal response to hypernatremia is excretion of maximally concentrated urine under the control of ADH. These responses are diminished in diabetes insipidus, DIA, where there is either impaired ADH secretion, which is called as central DIA, or resistance to the effect of ADH at the level of kidney, which is called as nephrogenic DI. So this results, DI results in an inappropriately dilute urine. Central DI is typically the result of damage to the neurohypophysis from trauma, neurosurgery, neoplasms, vascular accidents or infections. And nephrogenic DI can be classified into disorders associated with intrinsic renal diseases of the collecting duct where ADH acts. For example, polycystic kidney disease, obstructive nephropathy or sickle cell nephropathy, certain drugs like lithium, amphotericin, electrolyte disorders like hypercalcemia and hypokalemia, and conditions that reduce renal medullary hypertonicity. For example, excessive water intake and chronic use of loop diuretics. Now, one etiology of hypernatremia was diabetes insipidus. Next is osmotic diuresis. So, osmotic diuresis occurs when an osmolar load passes through the kidney, drawing out large amounts of water into the urine. Can you think of a condition that you have already read and it takes place? Osmotic diuresis. Yes, you are thinking right. It's diabetes mellitus. So, this commonly results from poorly controlled diabetes mellitus and its associated glycosuria. So, jitna osmotic load hoga, jitna glucose hoga, that will attract more water and there will be resulting hypernatremia in the blood. IV mannitol retained uremic toxins in recovering renal failure. They can also result in an osmotic diuresis. Okay. So, now we move on to the potassium, the other important electrolyte. So, plasma potassium level is normally 3.5 to 5 milliequivalents per liter. The total body potassium in a normal adult is approximately 3000 to 4000 milliequivalents, of which 98% is intracellular. So, perturbations in the serum potassium, therefore, are generally the result of the transcellular shifts and do not accurately reflect the total body potassium deficit or excess. Potassium excretion is primarily accomplished by the kidneys at the level of the collecting duct, under the influence of aldosterone. This process is coupled to sodium resorption and therefore volume repletion and blood pressure elevation. Aldosterone activity on the collecting duct also stimulates hydrogen ion excretion, and thus the acid-base status of the patient often offers a clue to the underlying cause of potassium disorders. This is very important to understand. Okay, now the principal causes of hyperkalemia, they could be, first is spurious or pseudo hyperkalemia. The potassium is not actually increased in the body, but you can see the lab report, it says hyperkalemia. How? The reason would be hemolysis, or if there has been a delayed separation of serum, or if there has been a contamination with an anticoagulant like potassium EDTA. So if you have taken a sample first in a lavender vial, blood collection vial that had potassium EDTA, and then you transferred that blood to a plain vial, what blunder are you doing? You are increasing the potassium concentration, which was not actually the case, which was not the reality. But now the report will tell it as hyperkalemia, because you have inadvertently you have increased the potassium concentration in the blood. So the pseudo hyperkalemia, which includes hemolysis, delayed separation of serum, contamination, for example, with potassium EDTA, abnormal blood cells, for example, leukemia and thrombocytosis. Then the second cause could be excessive potassium intake. Orally, rarely it happens. For example, a patient of, let's say, chronic kidney disease, you know, taking potassium rich foods like tender coconut water, that patient can land up in hyperkalemia, but normal people won't develop hyperkalemia as such. Then excessive potassium intake in parenteral infusion, that can result in excessive potassium intake, and then transfusion of stored blood. So this reason is very, you know, to be kept in mind when you are administering, you are transfusing blood to a patient of chronic kidney disease, because we always keep in mind that a patient of kidney disease, if he or she has to be transfused blood, it has to be fresh blood. It shouldn't be a stored blood for like 10 days, because stored blood will have more of, you know, red blood cell lysis, more of potassium content, which the patient is already not able to excrete out of the body. So this is a clinically very relevant point. Now, next causes of hyperkalemia is transcellular potassium movement, which could be due to tissue damage, for example, trauma, tumor lysis syndrome, catabolic states, systemic acidosis, lack of insulin, and transient hyperkalemia can be seen in vigorous exercise. Now, last but not the least is, and the most important in fact, is the decreased potassium excretion, which could be due to acute kidney injury or chronic kidney disease. And also there are certain drugs like potassium sparing diuretics, ACE inhibitors, and NSAIDs, non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs. Then mineralocorticoid deficiency, for example Addison's disease, or if a patient has undergone adrenalectomy, that would be functional mineralocorticoid deficiency. Now, about clinical features, hyperkalemia is less common than hypokalemia, but it is more dangerous through its effect on the heart. It can kill without warning. It lowers the resting membrane potential, shortens the cardiac action potential and increases the speed of repolarization. Cardiac arrest in asystole or slow ventricular fibrillation may be the first sign of hyperkalemia, and the risk increases significantly with potassium concentrations exceeding 6.5 millimole per liter, particularly if the increase has occurred rapidly. And a true potassium concentration of more than 7 is a medical emergency. Other clinical features of hyperkalemia include muscle weakness, hyperventilation could be present. Okay, now this algorithm is for evaluation of hyperkalemia. So in this box, this is ICF ECF exchange. There is a spelling mistake, please correct it. So few etiologies of special importance I'll discuss. First is transcellular shifts, very important. So the movement of potassium from the intracellular fluid to the extracellular fluid may transiently increase the plasma potassium without altering total body potassium content, often amplifying the hyperkalemia resulting from other causes. Now, potential causes of extracellular shift include insulin deficiency, ECF hyperosmolarity, inorganic acidemia, and cell breakdown. For example, rhabdomyolysis, hemolysis, and tumor lysis syndrome. Diabetic ketoacidosis may promote hyperkalemia through relative insulin deficiency despite the presence of total body potassium depletion. Although the patient is in total body potassium depletion, but may present to you with as hyperkalemia, because in the deficiency of insulin, the transcellular movement of potassium has taken place from intracellular to extracellular fluid. And then there are certain medications that cause extracellular shifts, which include non-selective beta blockers, digitalis, and succinylcholine. Now, after transcellular shift, the other important cause of hyperkalemia is reduced glomerular filtration. Diseased kidneys respond to progressive insufficiency with increased potassium excretion per functioning nephron. This compensation is typically adequate until the GFR falls to the point of oliguria. Third reason is effective aldosterone deficiency. Heparin, ketoconazole, ACE inhibitors, they decrease aldosterone production. And NSAIDs, they inhibit renin secretion from the kidney, thus decreased aldosterone levels. So please go through this algorithm and come back with your doubts. Now, hypokalemia, the principal causes, hypokalemia, we define it as less than 3.5 millimole per liter, and the principal causes include decreased potassium intake, oral, which is rare, parenteral could be the cause. Then transcellular potassium movement, it would be the opposite of what we have seen in hyperkalemia. So alkalosis, insulin administration, beta adrenergic agonist, and rapid cellular proliferation, these will all result in hypokalemia. Or there could be increased potassium excretion through kidneys due to diuretics, nephrotoxic drugs, for example amphotericin, and mineralocorticoid excess, which could be due to primary aldosteronism, secondary aldosteronism, Cushing syndrome, renal tubular acidosis. Then extra renal causes could be diarrhea, purgative abuse. So few patients who use purgatives for having good bowel movements, very often they'll end up having hypokalemia. Then vomiting, gastric aspiration through nasogastric tube, and excessive sweating. These conditions can lead to hypokalemia. The clinical features of hypokalemia include neuromuscular features like weakness, constipation, confusion. Cardiac features could include arrhythmias, and if a patient is already on digoxin, there could be potentiation of digoxin toxicity. And in renal causes, there would be impaired renal features, it would be impaired concentrating ability, leading to polyuria and polydipsia. And metabolic effects, if you see, there would be alkalosis. So this finishes potassium here, and this is the slide that shows you how you evaluate hypokalemia. So go through this slide. You don't have to, go into detail of every cause. The few important ones I have already discussed with you, and if you don't get anything, please come back with your doubts. And let's talk about chloride. So chloride concentration in plasma, as I told you, that intake, output, and metabolism of sodium and chloride, they run in parallel. So the chloride concentration in plasma is about 96 to 106 milliequivalents per liter or millimoles per liter, and in CSF it is about 125 milliequivalents per liter. So hypochloremia, it is less than 98 milliequivalents per liter. It is seen in cases of dehydration. Cushing syndrome, where mineralocorticoids cause increased reabsorption from kidney tubules. This is about, sorry, hypochloremia. Hypochloremia, the causes are excessive vomiting, which is the most common cause. Because through vomit, the hydrochloride, acid is lost, so plasma chloride is lowered. And there would be a compensatory increase in plasma bicarbonate. This is called as hypochloremic alkalosis. Then excessive sweating. This is another rare cause of hypokalemia, and persistent gastric secretions, like I said, excessive vomiting, these two are like one and the same thing. And in Addison's disease, aldosterone is diminished. So renal tubular reabsorption of chloride is decreased, and more chloride is excreted out of the kidneys. Then hyperchloremia, that is chloride concentration in plasma is more than 107 millimoles per liter, and the causes could be dehydration. Cushing syndrome, where mineralocorticoids cause increased reabsorption from renal tubules. Severe diarrhea, which leads to loss of bicarbonate and compensatory retention of chloride. Renal tubular acidosis. Now, next is bicarbonate. Although this will be taught to you in detail in the subsequent classes in pH balance and acid-base disorders. So it is the second most prevalent extracellular anion, and normal value of bicarbonate is 22 to 30 millimoles per liter. And in health, at normal plasma bicarbonate concentration, virtually all the filtered bicarbonate from the kidneys is absorbed. And kidneys are, of course, the main regulators of blood bicarbonate. They can form and release bicarbonate when low or excrete when in excess. So I will summarize the lecture here. So osmolarity means osmotic pressure exerted by number of moles per liter of solution on, and osmolality osmotic pressure exerted by number of moles per kg of solvent. Although we use these terms interchangeably, the body water contributes about 60 to 70% of body weight, that is 42 liters, and intracellular compartment that has 2/3 of it, that is 40% of body weight, and extracellular has 20%. And extracellular water is again distributed between intravascular, which constitutes 4% of body weight, and extracellular compartment, which constitutes 20% of body weight. Okay, then osmolality of plasma, it varies from 280 to 290 millimoles per kg. Sodium, potassium and water homeostasis, these are closely linked, and principal extracellular cation sodium and principal intracellular anion is intracellular cation is potassium. Sodium and potassium, as you know, sodium potassium ATPase, these are transported actively in the body, but the movement of water is passive in response to changes in solute contents of body fluid compartments. Sodium excretion primarily controlled by aldosterone. Water excretion controlled by vasopressin or ADH. Potassium excretion regulated in part by aldosterone, but also depends on extracellular hydrogen ion concentration and sodium and water excretion. Changes in plasma sodium concentration can be due to changes in amount of extracellular sodium or water or both. Hyponatremia is common. It is sometimes an appropriate physiological response to disease. Hypernatremia, less common than hyponatremia, and usually related to a decrease in body water. Then total plasma total potassium concentration, it's a poor guide to body's overall potassium status, because usually the potassium hypo or hyperkalemia is due to transcellular shift of the potassium. So depletion is not always associated with hypokalemia, and other way around is also true, that hypokalemia is not always due to potassium depletion. Hypokalemia is most frequently a result of excessive gastrointestinal or renal loss of potassium and may be exacerbated by a poor intake, or it could also be due to increased cellular uptake of potassium from the plasma. And hyperkalemia, it is most frequently due to decreased renal excretion or loss of potassium from cells. And or it could be iatrogenic, that means when you are administering a drug, the over treatment or inappropriate potassium administration can lead to hyperkalemia. And then you also have something called as pseudo hyperkalemia or spurious hyperkalemia, which is due to in vitro causes. And hyperkalemia is very dangerous, it can cause cardiac arrest. Thank you for being attentive, and this finishes this topic here, water and electrolytes. Please go through the slides, please listen to the lecture carefully, and concentrate upon the various charts and tables that I have given, and I will be discussing your doubts and will be posting a quiz. Let me know. Either it would be tomorrow or on Monday. I would prefer it to be tomorrow, if in case you are comfortable. So just let me know. Thank you.